I'm going to bring up someone who will introduce tonight's speaker. And our introducer tonight works for Google Brain Robotics. Did I get that right? And that sounds pretty exciting. And so he'll tell you a little bit about our speaker. But what I also want to mention about our speaker is he's not just a wonderful mathematician, but he's a very generously spirited person who you will hear from our introducer about their relationship. But I will also just say on a personal note, Joel Spencer, tonight's speaker, was a mentor for one of my three children and helped her develop a love of mathematics at a very early age. And so I'm very grateful to Joel and very delighted that he's here tonight. But first, let me turn it over to Krzysztof, who will share his own experiences and stories about Joel. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good evening. It's a great pleasure to introduce Professor Spencer. And I gave one short introduction at the 4 p.m. session, so I promise for those who attend this one, I will try to make it different. I mean, I cannot change it completely because, Professor Spencer is simply a brilliant mathematician and a wonderful person. But I want to talk about a couple of different things that I didn't mention before. Just like Cindy said, I work in Google Brain Robotics, New York, but I want to tell my story how Professor Spencer changed my life. And it was quite some time ago when I moved to New York and summer internship, at IBM, not Google that time. And I met Professor Spencer. I was very interested in mathematics, in random graph theory. But of course, I didn't have any results yet. He was the one who encouraged me to apply for the PhD program at top American universities, and I pretty much followed his suggestion. I ended up at Columbia University, a wonderful PhD program with Maria Shudnovsky, who is a very good close friend of Professor Spencer, another wonderful mathematician. And so pretty much from the very beginning of my career as a researcher, Professor Spencer played a very important role. As an advisor, in terms of mathematical support, but also giving very useful life advice, which is even more important. So he's definitely a wonderful mathematician. A giant in graph theory and combinatorics. I remember reading papers and books with proofs, with results from random graph theory, authored by Professor Spencer before I met him. So it was a great pleasure to work talk with him in person at the very beginning when I moved to New York. And then we started talking about mathematics working. He was never officially my advisor, but I consider him my academic grandfather. So I was I spent quite some time working during my PhD on one of the Erdős conjectures, Erdős Heinel conjecture. Professor Spencer was a very close collaborator of Paul Erdős. It was wonderful to talk with him about this stuff, lots of graph theory. He actually inspired one of the papers that was later published, pretty much predicting an existence of the very specific family of graphs with some very weird properties. It turns out those graphs exist, and we prove it in the paper. So it was wonderful to talk with him about mathematics. But really, the very important thing is that he taught me how to think about mathematics. Think about it as an art. It's an art, right? If you really work on that, you think about it this way. You look for beautiful ideas. If you work as a mathematician, you never think about. You have those ideas come in very unexpected moments, and do not necessarily need to have a piece of paper with you to think about them. So he taught me how to think them, how to come up with really nice, beautiful concepts. And I was very lucky to have him as my mentor. As people say, when you stand on the shoulders of giants, you always see more. And I was very lucky, and I'm very lucky to talk about mathematics, to work on that with Professor Spencer, and he's definitely a giant of mathematics. And ladies and gentlemen, Professor Joel Spencer, and his beautiful mathematics right now.
Thank you, Cindy, and Thank you, Krzysztof, for those very kind words. You know, hearing this famous phrase of Isaac Newton, if I have seen a bit further, it is because I have stood on the shoulders of giants. And Peter Winkler, a mathematician at Dartmouth, has a very nice parody of this that's quite appropriate since I'll be talking about the Hungarian mathematician Paul Erdős. He likes to say, if I have seen a bit further, it is because I have stood on the shoulders of Hungarians. And in the mathematical world, I think there's some truth to that. There's some truth to that. Leopold Kronecker, the great 19th century German mathematician, said it best. Die ganze Zahlen hat der liebe Gott gemacht, alles andere ist Menschenwerk. Or, in its most beautiful translation, God created the integers, the rest is the work of man. The work of man, the work of mathematicians, the work of Paul Erdős. Erdős was the quintessential 20th century mathematician, 1913 to 1997. He was a man with prodigious gifts. His mathematical theorems and conjectures were enormously influential, and indeed the influence has only increased over time. He was also extraordinarily fortunate. He was fortunate that he was born in 1913 in Budapest, Hungary. And the Hungarian community at that time, and even today, but really especially, this was a particularly golden period where they gave tremendous support to those youngsters that had conceptual abilities, that had mathematical or scientific abilities. There is a long list of people from that era: John von Neumann, Edward Teller, George Polya, Leo Szilard. A bit later, let me mention my colleague and friend, Peter Lax. There's a wonderful joke that John von Neumann was chairing the advisory committee to the United States Atomic Energy Commission. And he looked around the table and he said, "Oh, Einstein is not here today. Now we can speak Hungarian." So, apocryphal, but who knows. Which brings me to a non-mathematical joke, but one of my favorite language jokes, so I just love to tell it. And it concerns Billy Wilder. Some of you are too young. Billy Wilder was a great German movie director who then became a great American movie director. Among his films is Irma LaDuce, so I'm really dating myself here. And Some Like It Hot is also very good. That's right. Many, many great films. And the story is that he had a Hollywood party, and he invited everyone, including the Hungarian screenwriters. And you may not know that the Hungarians had a tremendous role in the screenwriting in those golden days, the 50s, 60s, into the 70s in Hollywood, including most notably in the 40s, with the writing of Casablanca, but many, many other films. And so the screenwriters came in a group, and as they often did, they moved into a corner of his palatial house and just started talking to each other in Hungarian. Well, Billy Wilder just got totally incensed. And he ran up to them and said, "Stop it, stop it, stop it. You are in America now. Speak German." It's a good story. I hope it's true because it's a great story. So Erdős was a csoda gyerek, a child prodigy. And this was something that was greatly prized and still greatly prized in Hungary. Indeed, we see it in every land we see people that are child prodigies, and he was one. One of his earliest memories, I remember him telling me about this, was of taking 250 from 100 and saying that the answer was 150 below zero. It's quite a conceptual leap. And by high school, he was doing research mathematics. There was a key paper that was joint work with George Sekeres and Esther Klein, and it was worked on when he was 19 years old. The three of them would walk the beautiful hills of Budapest and talk about mathematics. It's very melancholy to read the description George Sekeres wrote about it some 50 years later, because we know the horrors that were to overtake their world, and indeed the world as a whole. And there they were. He was the youngster at age 19, blissfully unaware of the future. Also at age 19, Erdős's fame spread well beyond Hungary. In 1852, Chebyshev proved that there's always a prime between any number and its double. Well, except for 1 and 2. So between 2 and 4, there's 3. Between 10 and 20, there's 11 and 13 and 17 and 19. So often there are many, many more than 1. But he gave a mathematical proof that there's always a prime between a number and its double. Then Erdős, it would be 1932, so 80 years later, he proved the same result. But he gave a much more beautiful proof, a more elegant proof, more what he called, and I'll get back to this, the book proof. And it was immortalized with a marvelous doggerel. Chebyshev said it, and I'll say it again, there's always a prime between n and 2n. And with that, he entered the world stage of mathematics at the age of 19, and he remained there proving and conjecturing until his death in 1997. Indeed, he was at a conference in Prague, and he was planning to go the next day to another conference. Now I'm forgetting. I think it was Estonia, but I'm not quite sure. And that's when he passed away. So as we like to say, he died with his boots on. He had a really wonderful, wonderful life. One really wonders just what it is in a culture that leads to great mathematics. To my mind, the abilities are everywhere, but certain cultures really foster this intellectual thinking, and in particular, the mathematical thinking. And many people have wondered, why is it that this time in Hungary was so good for mathematics? And there are all kinds of theories, but I'll give you my humorous theory about why it is, which is that when the young, so I'm what's called Tisztelet Magyar, honorary Hungarian, because I started going in 1976 and I never stopped, and it's just become this great enriching of my life, really wonderful part of my life. And so I go to people's houses and see their families, and I see them with their babies. And when they look at their babies and they smile, they don't cry out, "Yai de chinos, isn't that a beautiful baby?" Instead, they cry out, "Yai de okos, isn't that a clever baby?" And there's something there that the cleverness So it's a half joke, but who knows what's there. But it really is true that there's something that the culture prizes the cleverness. One can think of a similar thing with Ramanujan. You know, there's this wonderful book, The Man That Knew Infinity, by Kanigal, that was then made into a movie about Ramanujan and his relationship with Hardy. And he grew up in India, and he grew up poor, but he grew up in a culture that really prized mathematical thinking. I think this comes through more in Kanigal's book than in the movie, but it was definitely strongly there that the culture very much supported this intellectual endeavor. And to my mind, this is a critical thing, that some cultures really support mathematical, intellectual thinking, the idea that you don't have to be doing this in order to build a better mousetrap. You're doing this because of the joy of the purity of thought. And Hungary had it in 1913, and India, or at least his part of India, had it for Ramanujan when he was growing up. And I was also quite fortunate. So I, to get personal, was born, let's hear it, Brooklyn. Yes. Okay. But sad to say, my parents were the adventurous sort, and they were always looking for new horizons, and so they joined the Great Migration, and they moved to Queens. Yes. Yay! So I grew up in Queens. It wasn't so bad, actually, I have to say. I had a very good. I still miss Brooklyn, but. And I grew up in Queens Village, off near the Nassau County border. I went to a wonderful public high school. It's still there today, Martin Van Buren High. I can always, am very grateful to the Soviet Union for Sputnik. I was just in Moscow and I told them I was so happy about Sputnik because I was at the perfect age, and when Sputnik came, all of a sudden math was cool. And if you were on the math team, which I would have been anyway, suddenly math and science were exciting fields, and it totally revolutionized for kids like me the education. And so I was very, very fortunate. And I was also fortunate that Van Buren was an excellent school, though I have to say that Bronx High School of Science, Brooklyn Tech, Stuyvesant, they always beat us. So, but sometimes we were number four in the math competitions, and then I was very pleased. I think today there are many more schools, but at that time, those were the three schools that were in math and science. Also, I had a great math teacher. You know, you only need one, and I was very lucky. I had one. His name was Ira Ewan. He was a teacher and then principal in the New York City public school system for many, many years. And he showed me the beauties of mathematics. And if you want to do beauty, if you want to do mathematics, beauty is at the very center. Here's a quotation from G.H. Hardy, the man that is also in the film that worked with Ramanujan. And Hardy was considered the premier mathematician of his time at the turn of the last century, 1900, 1910, in fact, for many decades. But he wrote about this, and he said, "The mathematician's patterns, like the painter's or the poet's, must be beautiful. The ideas, like the colors or the words, must fit together in a harmonious way. Beauty is the first test. There is no permanent place in this world for ugly mathematics." Now, I'm not sure whether that's literally true about ugly mathematics, but it certainly is a beautiful sentiment. When I was in high school, my teacher, Ira Ewan, showed me a conjecture that had an enormous influence on me. It's called the twin prime conjecture. I think most people here know what a prime number is, like 7 or 37, a number that can't be factored into two numbers, unlike, say, 91, which is not prime because it's 7 times 13. So otherwise, the numbers are prime numbers. And twin primes are simply two primes that are two apart. So 11 and 13, they're both primes, so those count as twin primes. Or 101 and 103, or 571 and 573. Well, thanks to Krzysztof's colleagues, I could go on Google and find that one. So. And there are many, many more. But what is the conjecture? The twin prime conjecture is that the list goes on forever, that there are an infinite number of twin primes. But I emphasize the word conjecture because we don't know if this is true. We don't know if this is true. Now, with computers, we have enormous statistical evidence. And the evidence, the statistical evidence, is abundantly in favor of the twin prime conjecture. We can compute, we can check for twin primes out to 10 billion. One of our youngsters here can get on their cell phone and compute it out to 10 million by the end of this session. And you'll see that there are lots and lots of twin primes. This is less clear, but they seem to have a pattern in their frequency that we can conjecture. But all of that is conjecture. That's not a proof. So there are lots and lots of twin primes out to 10 billion that we computed. So the number is a lot bigger than the 1 million, say, that was computed years ago before computers. But maybe when we get to a Googleplex and 3, suddenly the twin primes stop. And for some reason we don't understand, there aren't any more. Now, I don't think that's going to happen. In fact, very few mathematicians think that's going to happen. But mathematics is about proof. And we don't have a proof that the twin prime conjecture is true, and we don't have a proof that the twin prime conjecture is false. It is indeed a conjecture. As I thought about it when I was in high school, well, I mean, I tried to do something with it, but I didn't get very far. So I joined the club, as it were. But as I thought about it, I had an epiphany, and I use the word deliberately. The epiphany was, well, the twin prime conjecture is either true or it's false. And this is an absolute. This is an absolute. So to explain what I mean, let me compare mathematics to the sciences. And generally, mathematics is not considered a science. And it has this special absoluteness. Think of biology. That's a fine subject, and nothing against biology. But is it absolute? Well, you know, we could imagine another world where we had silicon-based life forms. Indeed, sometimes at Google it seems that's already the case. So it's not an absolute thing about biology. Or even think of physics, which is closer. So here I have to stretch a little bit more. But still, you could imagine a universe where instead of an inverse square law, you'd have an inverse cube law for gravitation. So, but in mathematics, here is my faith. that the twin prime conjecture is either true or false, and whichever one it is, we could be on another planet, we could be another species, we could live in a different universe, in an alternate universe, it would still have the truth, same truth value. That is, my faith is that I cannot conceive of one universe where the twin prime conjecture is true, where there are an infinite number of twin primes, and another universe where it's false, where there are only a finite number of twin primes. Perhaps because the gods at Salin hat the Liebe Gott gemacht, that God created the integers. The integers are there, and they're there, and they transcend time and space. Let me give a wonderful quotation about this transcendence, not from a mathematician, but from an incredibly great author, Jorge Luis Borges, South American author. And he's a mathematician's favorite, even though I've never found any calculus formulas in his books. But he has a way of thought, and he wrote a short story that I highly recommend. It's called The Library of Babel. It's in his collection, Ficciones. And in this story, there is the protagonist is the librarian. And the librarian goes through this universal library. And he's searching for what Erdős will call, and I'll come to it soon, the book. He's looking for what Borges calls the total book, the book that has all knowledge in it. And at the critical moment, I carried this passage with me in my wallet for about 20 years. It's just, for me, it's very moving. And so the librarian cries out. He's searching and searching. And he says, "To me, it does not seem unlikely that on some shelf of the universe there lies a total book. I pray the unknown gods that some man, even if only one man, and though it have been thousands of years ago, may have examined and read it. If honor and wisdom and happiness are not for me, let them be for others. May heaven exist, though my place be in hell. Let me be outraged and annihilated, but may thy enormous library be justified for one instant in one being." Well, to me, this, and to many mathematicians, this resonates tremendously. For Erdős, the Erdős philosophy, or theology, one could call it, non-deist theology, but theology nonetheless, was in what he called the book, the book. And in the book, as he described it, were all the theorems of mathematics. And in the book, in my picture, on the left page, there was the theorem. And on the right page, there was a proof. But mathematicians know that when you have a theorem, often there are many different ways of proving it. But in the book, this Platonic structure that Erdős talked about, there was only one proof. And this was the proof that was the most beautiful proof, the most sublime proof, perhaps not the shortest proof, but the proof with the deepest understanding. And he called it the book proof. And this happened very frequently, that there were problems that people were working on and working on and working on, and then finally someone came up with a solution. And Paul would be very happy. He was very generous about mathematics. For him, it never mattered who proved the theorem. I mean, he would celebrate that person, But the important thing was that there was this discovery. So he would be very happy and tell everybody that the result had been proven. But then he would say, well, now we have a proof. But now let's search for the book proof. Let's search for the proof that shows the core ideas in the most beautiful way. And this idea of the book was a very powerful idea for all of us in Erdős's circle. I like to think that the circles, I like to think of concentric circles around Erdős. At the inner circle, there were four people. There was Andras Hoynal, Vera Shosh, Paul Turan, and Ron Graham. It's the one American. This is in my mind. And then there were concentric circles. I like to feel I was in the second circle. That's my own hubris. And then a third circle with some hundreds. And then a fourth circle. Sort of like Beijing, the rings keep going around. You keep building up more circles. And then in the end, there were just these thousands and thousands of people that had the contact with Erdős and were deeply influenced by him. I mean, certainly people were influenced by his great mathematics, but equally so, they were influenced by the power of his personality and his spirit just spread. Somebody recently described him like an apostle from the Catholic Church, and he was like that. If you saw the apostle, well, you know, then you would get the faith, and then you would spread the news. And he was like that. He was like that. And certainly I feel that when I'm talking to young talent, that I just hope that I'm able to do a fraction of what Paul was able to do to thousands and thousands of people. Mathematics has a wonderful international aspect to it, and Paul was epitomized this. He was constantly traveling. Here's a wonderful quote from a great logician and mathematician, Julia Robinson. She said, "I think of mathematicians as forming a nation of our own, without distinctions of geographical origins, race, creed, sex, age, or even time. The mathematicians of the past and you of the future are our colleagues too, all dedicated to the most beautiful of the arts and sciences." I had the good fortune of knowing Julia. She, very sad, she died quite young, but I did know her for a few years, and she had a wonderful, wonderful spirit and did great, great mathematics. Let me give another favorite quote of mine that just for fun, to get off the seriousness of it. This is from my favorite movie. Everybody has a favorite movie. No, it's not Terminator 2. No, although that's high up on the list. It's Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. Used to be Casablanca, but I've moved on to Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. And it's got millions of, it has great, great acting and beautiful cinematography. And it's a buddy movie and with Redford, Robert Redford and Paul Newman at the very heights of their careers. And Catherine Ross playing sort of the female foil, also doing a wonderful job. But there's so many great lines, but my favorite is at one point, Paul Newman, who plays Butch Cassidy, is coming up with ideas about, they're bank robbers, about how to rob the banks and what to do. And Robert Redford, who plays Sundance Kid, turns to him and he says, "You just keep right on thinking there, Butch. That's what you're good at." So that's what I think of myself sometimes, that I shouldn't get too high and mighty. I should just keep on thinking and hope for the best. Sometimes you get answers. Mathematics, it's a field where you know, if banging your head against the wall is something you enjoy, then mathematics is for you, because You know, you work on problems and the successes are wonderful, but most of the time, you know, you don't get success. There's another quote by Kelvin, you know, the Lord Kelvin, who is famous for the Kelvin temperature scale, but also did not just that. I mean, he was a great scientist, and he said, "One word describes my most strenuous efforts for the advancement of science, and that word is failure." And I've always taken to that. I think you just have to see it in a positive way. You have to see that, you know you're struggling, sort of like Jacob wrestling with the devil. You know, you know, or with the angel, whichever one it was. I flunked Bible, I'm sorry. But it was the angel. But Jacob wrestling with the, thank you, with the angel. Most of the time the angel wins, but still you keep on trying, and when you get successes, it's really sweet. So let me mention, in terms of the twin prime conjecture, well, it's still open, but I want to mention a success. And this was just recently 2012, so maybe not recently for the youngsters in the crowd, but for most of us, that was recent. And it was done by a mathematician whose name is Yitang Zhang. And in fact, there are a number of documentaries about this. You can go on YouTube and look up Yitang Zhang. One of them is by George Chichery, and it's called Counting to Infinity, and it tells his story. And he had a PhD in mathematics. He was at University of New Hampshire. It was really quite interesting. He didn't have a full faculty position. You know, he was teaching there, and people knew he was kind of a bright guy. You know, he was working on this number theory. And he thought and thought about the twin prime conjecture. And no, he didn't solve it. That would be a much better answer. But the twin prime conjecture is that there are infinite number of pairs of primes that are two apart. And he proved that there are infinite number of pairs of primes that are within 60 million of each other. And this was a tremendous breakthrough, because the 60 million was a constant, and nobody knew that there was any constant before. So, well, 60 million is kind of a large number, and since then, enormous numbers of mathematicians have worked on this to try and refine his ideas and to get new ideas, and he continues to work on. Right now, I believe the current result is that there are infinitely many pairs of primes that are within 210, but I may have the number wrong. And it's an ongoing thing where people are doing for. Again, it's not the twin prime conjecture that there are an infinite number of pairs of primes that are two apart. But we feel that this problem is not a brick wall. We feel, and we may well be wrong, that there's been progress in working. We're getting new techniques. The new techniques are giving us some results, even if they don't give the full result. And so there's some hope that maybe not in my lifetime, but maybe in the lifetime of some of the younger people here, that the twin prime conjecture will be solved. But maybe not. The thing with conjectures is you just don't know. You don't know. Erdős frequently asked problems, and he had an interesting element that he would give cash prizes for his problems. But you know, after he died, some people tried to duplicate, but it couldn't be duplicated because he would ask problems. First of all, they were open problems. They weren't exercises. They were open problems. Now, in mathematics, it's fairly easy to come up with a question that somebody will solve at lunch. And it's also not so difficult to come up with a problem that nobody will solve in 500 years. But Erdős had a way, there would be some area, and he'd be working on it and working on it, and he would get to a point, and he would have some results, but he wanted to, but he didn't have the full solution. So he would ask a question, and in order to solve that question, you'd have to come up with a new idea, but not 10 new ideas, maybe one or two new ideas. And so you would advance the subject. And one of the things that I was very, very proud of when I was quite young was I managed to solve an Erdős problem. And I got a check from him. And it was a check for $10. It was so, so nice. It was really a wonderful, wonderful moment. I was told I had to, people weren't cashing his checks, and so it was a big, big mess. So I was told, no, you have to cash the check. So I Xeroxed the check, and I put it, and it was on my wall for many years, the Xerox of it. He asked questions with various amounts. Let me mention one question that was his favorite question. And I will slightly simplify it. Let's see if that's okay. So this question deals with arithmetic progressions. So arithmetic progressions are like 13, 19, 25, 31, 37. So the difference is the same. So that's called an arithmetic progression. It can start anywhere, and you look at how many we're not talking about infinite progressions. We're talking, but he was interested in long arithmetic progressions. And there are a lot of long arithmetic progressions, and he felt that if you had a set that had a lot of numbers in it, well, I'll make it more precise. If you had a set that had a lot of numbers in it, then it would have in it long arithmetic progressions. And more particular, now here I'm putting in particular numbers, but let me say this. Suppose you have a set S, and it's in the first n integers, and think of n as a Googleplex, as some really, really large number. But suppose S is a really large set that has a third of the elements. So that's got lots and lots of elements. Then what he said was, no matter what set you pick, in that set, you'll get an arithmetic progression of 50 terms, of 50 terms. Now, the actual conjecture, the 50 could be any particular number, and the one-third could be any particular number. But this is an illustrative example. And he made this conjecture. He made it along with his colleague, Paul Turan. They were great collaborators. Turan was a couple of years his senior. They were both great Hungarian mathematicians. And they came up with this conjecture. So it became known as the Erdős-Turan conjecture. I mean, people had already, arithmetic progressions are a very natural thing to study when you're studying the integers. And it was a very early conjecture. He came up with it in the late 30s. And he offered, I'm not sure how much he offered originally for it, I'm not even sure if he was offering money at that time. But when I came on the scene, he was offering $1,000, and that was his biggest prize. So mathematics, you think, well, all these people have tried it, and nobody succeeded. I mean, there must be just something impossible, or maybe it's false, or we don't know. Sort of like the way we think about the twin prime conjecture now. Maybe we're just not going to have any success. But it turned out then in, I believe it was 1971, plus or minus a few years, a Hungarian mathematician, Andrei Semeredi, proved this statement. So n has to be a big number, maybe a Googleplex. I mean, exactly what how big n has to be was part of the proof. But let me just say, for some large number n, like a Google, notice that if it's a Googleplex, the set is contained in the first Googleplex numbers, but it's got an enormous number of numbers in the set. Oh, sorry, the vertical lines just mean size. That's mathematics for size. It means the number of elements of S is at least a third of the numbers from 1 to n are in this set. That's what it's saying. And so this was proven by Andre Semmeretti in 1971, and it was a great, great result. It's one of the great results in discrete mathematics. Very, very involved proof. And in 2002, Semmeretti was awarded the Abel Prize for this work and some other works, but this played, this wasn't the only thing he did. He was and is a great mathematician. But he was, so the Abel Prize, some of you know that there's not a Nobel Prize in mathematics, but in the early 2000s, it was decided to create a new prize, and so Norway and Sweden have shared the Nobel Prizes. Different ones are awarded by different countries. But Norway decided to create the Abel Prize, and I had the wonderful good fortune to go, because I'm a friend of Semmeretti's, and we've worked together. Of course, he solves the $1,000 problems. I solve the $10 problems, so not quite at the same level, but he's a wonderful, wonderful human being. And I had the good fortune to go to Oslo, and he was presented the prize by the King of Norway, and it was really a beautiful thing. And here was this problem, just this beautiful, beautiful problem that remained open for decades and decades and decades, and then finally it was solved. Of course, there are many other problems that remain unsolved. So let me give a problem that Erdős offered $10,000 for, but it still is unsolved to today. So it has a little bit of notation, so I'll try and do it slowly. So again, we're going to want arithmetic progressions. And now we're going to have a subset of the integers. And I'm going to make an assumption about the set. So this is a little bit technical. I'm going to assume that if you sum the reciprocals of all of the elements of the set, that it becomes an infinite sum. Now, some of you may have seen that if you take the integers themselves and you sum 1 plus a half plus a third plus a fourth plus a fifth, the sum becomes infinite. It's an infinite sum. On the other hand, if you take the squares and you sum 1 plus a fourth plus a ninth plus a 16th plus a 25th, then the sum is finite. In fact, I think it's pi squared over 6, one of those strange things in mathematics. But here the point is it's finite. So sometimes the sum is infinite, and sometimes the sum is finite. And Erdős's $3,000 conjecture, or $10,000 conjecture, actually now I'm forgetting. It's only 7. It's the glory that's important, not the money. that if the set has this property, so there have to be a lot of elements in it, though it's a technical property. So like the squares are too sparse, so their sum of the reciprocals is finite, but all the integers, then the sum is infinite. And the conjecture of Erdős was that if S is so big that it has this property, then S necessarily contains an arithmetic progression, actually not just to 50 terms, but for any number, any fixed number of terms. After all, it's an infinite set. So even of 1,000 terms, somewhere in the set, you may have to go way out far to find it, there is this progression. And this remains an open problem, but again, there has been tremendous progress. One of the key examples of a set here is the prime numbers. And it's not easy to prove, but it is true that the sum of the reciprocals of the primes, so a half plus a third plus a fifth plus a seventh plus an eleventh plus a thirteenth plus a seventeenth plus dot, 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 that is an infinite sum. It's not obvious. After all, some sums, like the sum of the reciprocals of the squares, is finite. So it's not clear which things are finite and which things. But this was known, that this sum was finite, was infinite. So this was a key example. So in particular, if you prove this conjecture, one thing it would say was that the primes contain arithmetic progressions of length 50. Now, indeed, no one's found an arithmetic progression of length 50 in the primes. I think the record now is about something in the 20s. And this is with massive computation. But there was amazing progress. And in 2004, the mathematicians Terry Tao, who's the international nature, Chinese heritage, Australian upbringing, and he's at UCLA, and Ben Green, who's English, and in 2004, they didn't prove this conjecture, but what they did prove was that the primes contain arbitrarily long arithmetic progressions. So this was an open question that people had worked on for a long time, and it was finally resolved by Tao and Green. And in part for that, Terry Tao was awarded our biggest award for young mathematicians, for mathematicians under the age of 40. It's called the Fields Medal, and he was awarded the Fields Medal, and actually Terry Tao has done many, many great things, but this was one of the many great things that he did and was mentioned in his award of the Fields Medal. So in mathematics, we have these problems. They're open problems. People struggle with them for years and years and years. But sometimes we get successes. We get successes. So it's nice to talk about the successes and not all the years and years with that. So now let me turn to the game. And Tony, where are you? Tony, come on up, Tony. It's like the price is right. Oh, bring some chips. Sorry, I don't have any chips. Can you bring some chips? And do we have a microphone for Tony? Okay, so Tony, I'm gonna guess where you're from just by looking at you. I'll guess that you're from where I was born, Brooklyn. No, I get two guesses, and then you can tell me. Well, if it's not Brooklyn, No. New Jersey? No. I give up.
Manhattan.
Okay. Well, you've come a long way, baby. All right. Let's try a game. And we're going to try this game, and then we'll have some time, and we can all play with it. And we're going to try variant one. So we're going to start with five blue chips, and we're going to have five rounds. And we're going to have two players, Paul and Carol. And Tony, would you like me to pick, or do you want to say which one you want to be? Either one?
Paul.
Okay. So Tony is Paul, and I will be Carol. And so we're going to have five rounds, and Paul is going to split the chips, and then we'll just split them over here so we can see them up on the board, and then I will take one of the piles, and my object is not to take a lot of chips, because if there are two or more chips left at the end of the game, then I have won the game. So I am Carol. Oh, and then the meta question, for those of you that are good at anagrams, is we spell Carol with an E, so you might think of the anagram while we're doing the game. So, okay, so I am Carol, so you're Paul, so you can split the chips. Okay, so he puts three and two. Now, I want him to keep chips, so what I'm going to do, I don't want to take chips, but I have to take one of the piles. So I'll take two of these, but when I take a blue chips are special. When I take a blue chip, I have to return a red chip. Try it again. Now he takes those two, and okay, I will take these. But I've taken two blues, so I'll give you back two reds. So that's at the end of two rounds. We're going to have five rounds, and Paul, as we now call Tony, is trying to get down to one chip. He can't get down to zero chips, because when he splits it, if one was empty, I would just take the empty one. So it's impossible for you to get one chip. All right, you're doing this. I'll take these two. Okay. Uh-oh, now you've almost won because they're just two chips. Ah, but I will take this one. So you still have two chips, but there's one round left. And the winner is Paul. So congratulations. Well done. So now we'll take, let's take around 10 minutes, and please help yourself. And I'll be walking around if you have any questions about the game. I'll try and describe the rules. Let me end with just some Erdős anecdotes, and then be happy to open things up for questions. But one of Erdős's favorite phrases was, I have no home, the world is my home. And he lived his life in a special way. This was literally true that he would just travel from place to place to place. He would come to my house with my family, and he would come at that time I was at Stony Brook, so he would come out to Long Island, and he would stay for 3 or 4 days, and he would talk to me, he would talk to his Hungarian mathematician friend Peter Seuss, and many, many other mathematicians at Stony Brook, and he would do that for 3 or 4 days. And then he would fly off to Michigan, and from Michigan it was to Los Angeles, and from Los Angeles it was to Melbourne. And he just, He just traveled from place to place, and wherever he went, there were people there to welcome him and welcome him into their homes like we did. Besides his mathematics, he was a wonderful guest. He always asked about the family. He had a prodigious memory. He knew. So he always asked about the children, and he always brought gifts, and he was also always concerned about how the family was. There was only one thing about it about him as a guest that was a little bit difficult, which was that he would wake up at 5 in the morning. And I heard that this happened with many other people. And I'd hear this knock on our bedroom door, and it would be Paul, and I'll try to give him, he had this heavy Hungarian accent, which I can speak some Hungarian, but I'll try and do the Hungarian accent in English, which is, "Joel, Joel, is your brain open?" Well, it was 5 in the morning, Paul. I mean, most people wake up a little bit later, but no, he was awake. But one further thing I want to say is that one thinks of Paul. Of course, he was intensely involved in mathematics. That was his profession and his life. But it would be wrong to think that he was only interested in mathematics. He was supremely interested in history, and he was supremely interested in politics. He was totally international, so he knew people all over the world, and so he would discuss the history of the different countries, which he knew backwards and forwards. And we talk about the politics, not just when he was in America, the politics of America, but the politics of the Soviet Union and of France and of Australia and of England and indeed of the entire world. So in that sense, I think it's important to think about him that, yes, mathematics was the center of his life, but he was a man that was really interested in life and had this tremendous interest in people. Sometimes the popular press, quite naturally, emphasized his idiosyncrasies. To be sure, waking up at 5 in the morning was one of them, and so he did have them. But to me, I always think of him as the most social of mathematicians. He had this wide set of friends all around the world, and wherever he went, there were people that were there to welcome him, to do math with him, to talk with him, to laugh with him. And I miss him. I miss him. So thank you for listening, and we'll have some questions too.
I'm sure somebody has some questions they will ask in private of our speaker, but why don't we ask them in public right now? So I know you've got a question out there.
Thanks for your talk. Why did we play this game?
Sorry?
Why did we play this game?
Oh, why did we play this game? This was a version of something that I and many other people have written a lot of papers on called the liar game, where you're trying to, again, they're called Paul and Carol, and it's like 20 questions where Paul's trying to find a number from, say, 1 to 100, and he has 10 questions. But Carol can lie with her answer, but she's only allowed to lie once. And it turns out that mathematics is filled with these things that look completely different and yet are the same. This is really the liar game. If you think that I'm thinking of a number from 1 to 100, you just take 100 blue chips and mark them from 1 to 100. And then when you ask the question, is the number less than or equal to 50, you put the numbers less than or equal to 50 on one side and the numbers greater than 50 on the other side. And then when Carol says yes, she keeps the numbers from 1 to 50, but the numbers from 51 to 100 don't get thrown away. They become red chips instead of blue chips because she's already lied for those answers. So it's a little subtle, but it turns out this thing with chips is the same as the liar game. And then to back up yet another step, My first job was at AT&T Bell Labs at Murray Hill, New Jersey. Wonderful spot. And they were interested in sending messages. I mean, they're the telephone company. What else are they going to do? So they want to send messages. So let's think of the messages with bits, zeros and ones. But occasionally, a bit would get garbled, and a zero would come out a one, and a one would come out a zero. And what they wanted to do was design systems so that even though there was, say, one garble, it would still be correctable. They would have a system. In fact, this was used most famously on the Mars, one of the Mars rovers for transmitting things to Earth. And it turns out that is quite, this changing the zero to a one or a one to a zero is like a lie. And so it actually comes, for me personally, back to my very first job at AT&T Bell Labs.
There are more than one anagram to be made from the word Carol, name Carol.
No, who got the anagram?
I got one.
You got one?
Yeah.
Say what it is.
Oracle.
Oracle is the anagram. You got it right. Maybe there are others, I don't know, but Oracle is the one that I'm thinking of. And so Carol is like the Greek oracle, she always answers the questions, but... Oh, so this is in the liar game format, where Paul is asking the questions and Carol is answering. And like the oracles in Greek mythology, she always gives an answer, but it's not particularly helpful, so... So we felt, and thank you to Professor Ron Rivest at MIT, we wanted to use Paul, because it was Paul Erdős, and the natural thing would have been Vera, because Vera Shosh was one of his closest collaborators, but somehow it didn't, I don't know, we didn't like it or whatever, and so we came up with Carol, and we didn't like that either, and then finally Ron Rivest said, oh, just add the E, and like you said, you get Oracle, So we stick with, now the names of the players are Paul and Carol, forevermore. We're not changing it.
Have there not been, or will there not be, other vagabond mathematicians, or was was this the one and only?
Well, that's a good question. I mean, to my mind, there are a select few at this very, very top level that Erdős was at. So in that sense, he's not unique. And then there are a number of people that are total vagabonds. So in that sense, he's not unique. But my feeling is that if you look at the intersection of the two, then he is unique. At least I don't know of anyone else that does such great mathematics and had such a unique lifestyle.
You said that you were in the second ring.
Yeah.
You have an Erdős number of two?
One.
You are a one.
Because I did write joint papers with Erdős. And the rule with the Erdős number is if you write a joint paper, even just one joint paper, though I've written several, if you write a joint paper with Erdős, then you have an Erdős number of one. To get an Erdős number of two, you just have to write a paper with somebody that's written a paper with Erdős. It's sort of like there was an old song, I mean old, like before my time, I danced with the man who danced with the girl who danced with the Prince of Wales. It sounds like the Erdős number. But actually, I have to say, there have been occasions when I've been talking to some mathematician, and they keep saying, oh, we got this result. Oh, we really should write it up. And I really feel like what they really want is the Erdős number of two. They're really not interested in me at all. So. But yes, my number is one. Yeah.
All right, then. Let's give our speaker one more hand.
Thank you.